Arguably, Van de Graaff were a truly progressive band in that they progressed every element of the band.
We all came up with our own parts, whatever we were doing, and which made this very unusual sound.
I don't know where they came from. We never know who wrote what, you know.
If you put it all down on paper, you say, well, that's not going to work. But you listen to a Van de Graaff generator record, and it's all there, and it works perfectly.
They weren't easy to listen to. You had to work at it, but it was worth working at because the rewards were so huge.
Is Van de Graaff generator rock music? Well, I think it is. I think it rocks like a mother.
It either sucked you in or it spat you out.
Just one breath and since I'm dead, it's the aerosol grey machine. Just one breath and since I'm dead, it's the aerosol grey machine.
To understand what aerosol grey machine was, you really have to go back to the birth of Van de Graaff generator. It started in Manchester with Chris Judge-Smith and, of course, Peter Hammill.
When I got to Manchester University, I answered an ad which said, anyone interested in rock music, come to room C16. So about 20 guys with clutching guitars turned up. There was one guy sitting on the floor playing a song, singing a song to himself, and I stopped and I listened. And he had an amazing voice, and the song was fantastic. And I thought, aha, this is the man. And this is Peter Hammill. So that was how the band started. Once we got a full band together, there wasn't really a tremendous amount left for me to do, apart from stand there and wave a tambourine and do backing vocals. So I decided it would be better for the band if I bowed out. I mean, it was obvious the band were going to go places.
They were managed by Tony Stratton-Smith, who just formed Charisma Records. And he felt that they had a bad deal and didn't really want them to record with Mercury. But actually, the band weren't doing very well anyway. And things came to a head when they had their equipment stolen outside a gig. And at this point, the band got quite depressed and broke up. So Peter decided that it was then safe for him to record with Mercury Records as a solo artist.
Peter Hammill went in and did Aerosol Grey Machine. And then he decides, well, I need musicians. Who do I know? I don't really know anybody in London. I know. I'll call up my old mates from Van de Graaff Generator.
And things went pretty well. They, in fact, recorded the whole album in 2 days. And, in fact, they went so well that the band thought that they would get back together again, which they duly did.
So he got back the band, did an album under the name Peter Hammill, which was effectively the first Van de Graaff Generator album.
But, of course, their manager didn't want them to record for Mercury Records, so he wouldn't let the rest of the band sign. Only Peter Hammill was signed to them.
But because it was him guiding it and pushing it, it's very much a solo album under that guise. And if you listen to that album, you've got tracks like Necromancer, which is definitely very Van de Graaff Generator, whereas you've got a track like Octopus, which is very much pushing in the Peter Hammill solo vein. So it's a mixture of both.
Now I cannot see too clearly. And already my tread is stand bare.
The musicianship is very high, of high standard, and the experimentation. And I think, although it was recorded quickly, they knew what they wanted to do.
It's typically quirky, and I think if you heard it in isolation from the Van de Graaff Generator catalogue, you'd probably pinpoint it as being slightly more of a Hammill solo album, because it is slightly more subdued, it's slightly more esoteric, perhaps, than the later output. But I think instrumentally, it is a very formative album.
To me, it's interesting, some good songs in it, but it's got a very 60s type of feel compared to the later stuff.
It's a curio, like many of those first albums by what would be seen as the great progressive rock bands. For enjoyment, I will always go to stuff later in the band's career.
Looking back, it's full of holes and it doesn't stand up particularly well, but in terms of what it meant to the future, it's majorly important.
Thank you.
for me, very much the whole thing sort of kicks off with "The Least We Can Do Is Wave to Each Other."
"The Least We Can Do Is Wave at Each Other," which is one of those great Van de Graaff Generator album titles, was the first proper Van de Graaff Generator album. This was the album they made without the Peter Hammill solo sword of Damocles dangling over them. They went in as a band. This was a democratic unit and said, right, okay, now what are we going to do? We're going to do it together and we're going to do it locked in as a band. And because of that, it has more cohesion. And because of that, I think it's the first proper Van de Graaff Generator album. Tracks like "Darkness" had that ability to open up a new horizon for them.
I worked out this very kind of brooding, insistent bass lines that will underpin it structurally. And I think Dave Jackson played some really great sax in it, you know. And again, there's that real momentum. It sort of formed itself, but we all put in our own parts and it worked very well.
"Darkness," you know, was a classic track for us, a great opening track. You know, we'd go on stage and start, and, you know, with all the gentle rhythmic cymbals and wind and moaning and things. And then suddenly you hit the verse and you've got, you know, power, double horns and double saxes.
"Darkness," I mean, is you plunge headfirst into the world of music that this very odd and eccentric but quite enthralling band created. I mean, they plunge you headfirst. There's no mucking around. There's no sort of dilly-dallying. It's like, woof, in you go.
You've got Peter Hammill's screaming vocals. You've got David Jackson's howling saxophone. It's sonorous organ from Hugh Banton. All of it driven along by this bass riff. It's really quite ferocious and feels like almost having your brain sucked out of your skull.
It's got all the elements that we now think of as being classic Van de Graaff. It's got an amazing tune that doesn't do what you think it's going to do. It's got deep, complex lyrics. It's got Jackson and Banton, this extraordinary duo of the organ and saxophones being electronically mangled.
We were very physical on stage. You know, Hugh played stage right, I played stage left. That was always seemed the balance. He had his big organ stacks and power, and I had my saxophone stacks and power. And to get the balance, you know, the double horns against the organ was what became our sound.
For a Peter Hammill song, this is relatively conventional, at least as regards the chord sequence. This makes it quite an accessible track for people starting off listening to the music.
This is basically a three-chord song, but what's interesting about it is he uses an E root, and then he plays a C major chord over an E root and a D major chord over an E root. And it creates a tension which works really quite well with the lyrical content of Van de Graaff Generator / Peter Hammill. So the C and the D are creating the tension against the E root. And this is very typical of the type of things that Peter Hammill would write, and, as I say, put it to the rest of the band, who would improvise or work out their parts once he'd presented the song to them.
Quite often he'd come up with really quite a, well, to varying degrees, sometimes quite worked out, and other times like quite a loose sort of skeleton of a structural thing to which, you know, we had virtually co-create the music, you know.
Today dawns dark, it now numbers.
Day dawns dark, it now numbers infinity. Life crawls from the past, watching in wonder. I trace its patterns in me.
The lyrics are always completely baffling with Van de Graaff Generator. Numerous interpretations can be made. Hamel, immensely talented lyricist, superb poet, but very obscure.
I've got to tell you that I think he's a genius, and that's not a word I fling around in a casual way. He has this extraordinary gift of focus and creativity, and all this creativity and this intelligence has been poured into the art of songwriting.
Peter Hamel also redefined what a rock and roll vocalist was supposed to be about, in that he didn't follow any of the conventional patterns of singing. He would use his voice and fly into the upper registers, make almost sort of animal howling noises before returning to grunts, growls. These were not in the usual rock and roll repertoire, at least not in the way that Peter performed them.
I think he was better with Van de Graaff Generator than he was with any of his solo material. I think the band gave him the expanse to really move and flow and experiment.
Hamel's always been at his best, I think, when exploring the darker side of life, the fears, the nightmares and so forth, and doing it in a fractured and fragmented way, and allowing the band almost to follow him. He sets the lead with the words, and they almost try to juxtapose what they do inside that particular framework. And it worked beautifully with Darkness because it's eerie.
There's not much hope in some of Van de Graaff Generator's music. In fact, Bruce Dickinson from Iron Maiden, who's a big fan, once described their music as positively wrist-slashing stuff. Now, I wouldn't go that far.
This song has a particularly wonderful bass riff. It's an absolute monster, and it is typical Nick Potter. It holds the whole thing together, and it's him announcing his arrival on the scene.
Nick Potter's bass part on Darkness starts beneath the piano, and once the piano moves off into another area, it kind of builds by itself in a kind of bolero-like fashion. It's a basic riff, but as the song progresses, he adds his own color to this basic riff until it becomes literally a tour de force that drives the entire song.
I'm not an average kind of bass player. I got into using quite a lot of effects, in fact, and I do a lot of things that I've never heard any other bass player do. I'm quite a powerful player. But I come up with a lot of lines. But I mean, I'm also a writer in my, you know, as well. I've made solo albums and what have you. So I kind of know about structures and what have you. So I wouldn't call myself a straight bass player.
And Nick Potter was a very good bass player, I think, because he had a bit of taste, he had feel, you know, the groove. These are the important things for him as a bass player. Some of the tracks required a bit of technical ability, which he obviously had. So he came, I think, from the right school of music. It wasn't just technical. That is quite prevalent on not just Darkness, but quite a lot of the tracks that he was involved in.
I don't think you turn around and say he was a genius. In musical terms, I think it'd be fairly hard to say that about almost any bass player, but he was a highly competent bass player.
He's just perfect for the job. He fits in beautifully. He sounds completely assured, completely at home with this weird music. Even the sound he uses is just perfect.
And he anchored a lot of the music, so that when they went off on their flights of fancy, there was always the man there rooting it.
Really, I think the best thing that you can say about him, you know, as a bass player, is that he didn't stick out. And in those terms, that's actually that's actually praise and not criticism.
The combination of Potter and Guy Evans in Van de Graaff Generator was one of pretty much locking together and making sure there was a solidity. There was nothing particularly outlandish about what they did, although both could actually go off and explore if they needed to. They weren't bad musicians at all, but what they did was combine the way that a drummer and a bassist really should do.
Well, Guy Evans, first of all, is an excellent drummer, and you know, he's got lots of musicality within his drumming. Not just a technical drummer. He could do the sort of the funky chicken drumming as well as the sort of fast technical stuff. And when he had Nick in the band, they locked together really well. And as I said, they created the engine room of the band. And I for me, any band has to have a solid rhythm section.
They're very different. Guy Evans is sort of almost like a psychedelic jazz drummer, really.
His interjections and fills are not like regular rock drummer's stuff. It doesn't come at the end of every eight bars. The drummer goes, dub, 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 dub. You don't get that with Guy. You get an extraordinary short passage of solo percussion work suddenly pops out and moves the song on in a different direction.
There's no other drummer like him. It's not like a standard straight four type drummer at all. They can do that stuff if required. Very intuitive and very powerful, but on a big stage he can really hack it and comes alive.
Whatever would Robert have said is actually about Robert Van de Graaff, the scientist who inspired Van de Graaff Generator and indeed gave them their name. The song is characterized by Hugh Banton's magisterial organ work, which really comes from his church background.
The classical church sound that Hugh Banton portrayed became very quickly one of his trademarks, but it became a trademark of the band as well.
Well, Hugh is basically Mr. Organ, if I could put it that way. I mean, he was primarily an organist. He's an expert on church organs. Even with Van de Graaff, when he was in Van de Graaff before, he built his own organ. Look, I mean, he's like Rob Boffin. You know, he's Mr. Organ.
People say that Hugh Banton's organ style is churchy. Well, I think this is really the wrong word to use. He's a classically trained musician. He's Royal College of Organists, as far as I can remember.
Great player, very unique, very original, unlike any other.
But essentially, he's a really good organ player in the sense that he would play bass pedals when Nick Potter wasn't in the band. They didn't have a bass player, so he'd be playing bass pedals. And he also was able to see the bigger picture musically. He would create sort of slightly odd sounds, so he understood the instrument very well.
Hugh often would realise that we needed this to finish the piece, to resolve all of the things that were going on. And he'd say, give me an evening, give me an afternoon. And we'd all go off and throw a cricket ball at a wall or something. And he would write some incredible chordal development, which would take us a day to understand, let alone play. And, but you know, he was at the height of his powers in terms of arranging things in those days.
Quite an intriguing piece of music. And it is, it's a great example, I think, of the way that Banton would use that sort of, that particular keyboard sound.
I think listening to that track, you can see hallmarks of ideas and contributions coming to people from different members of the band in terms of the arrangements and the structure of the pieces. I felt like, you know, I had arrived in Van der Graaf. All the things I'd been doing for all these years. I mean, I started when I was about 13. So Van der Graaf comes along, I'm, you know, doing it for 8 or 9 years. I think I know how to play, I want to play.
David Jackson was and is, again, a great free-form musician. One who goes off on his own and seems to lose his way so often. But you never get tired of following the journey. You may end up in a cul-de-sac, but what a great cul-de-sac it was. And sometimes with David Jackson, you feel the journey is far more intriguing than the actual destination.
Often when we were playing between the organ, Peter on guitar, or Peter on keyboard, or Peter on voice, you're not absolutely sure who played that. God, it was me. You know, not absolutely sure who played what at certain moments of confusion.
Something very special about his playing. He can be extremely emotive, almost in a way that when you hear his playing, it stirs something, you know, you kind of feel like a tear's about to come. It's a weird thing, you know, he can be like that. Or very kind of powerful.
He plays saxophone like it was an electric guitar.
You listen to it and he caters for, he fills the space where you might expect the guitar to be with the most wonderful array of sounds from his various saxophones.
He is an amazing musician. He's capable of tremendous lyricism and great blasts of raw power.
I'm not a saxophone player who sits around smoking a cigarette, you know, waiting for the solo to come in about 10 minutes' time. I should play a solo or something. I'm not like that. I've just got to be part of the music all the time.
I mean, the trick he had was doing the double saxophone, playing two at once, which is almost like the double neck guitar. Again, it was a trick. It was a fairground trick, if you want, something like that. But it worked well because not only was he actually impressing visually and people going, wow, look at what he's doing, it actually did have a great sound.
What I really remember from those early sessions was, you know, he'd be standing there without being amplified at all, and the sheer volume coming from his saxophones, you know, it was like he had two Marshall amps, you know, stacks going up, you know, Mark 11 volume, you know, unbelievable. It's like you almost had to, you know, can you turn it down a bit, just acoustically.
You have to bear in mind that I was playing with effects. I was playing with octave dividers, so it wasn't just two saxophones. Sometimes it was, I mean, in the most ridiculous sounds, it was eight, because I've got one up, one, two up, one up, and one below, two below, and that's the one I'm playing. So, I mean, effectively, it's a ridiculous five-note chord with all the split harmonics in it. It's just grunge, basically, before grunge existed. This is the kind of wallop that I was able to do.
The least we can do is wave to each other is far, far better than the Aerosol Grey Machine. I mean, on a personal level, it's my favourite Van de Graaff Generator album. I mean, I think it's fantastic.
The least we can do is wave at each other. It was a better album than Aerosol Grey for three major reasons. One, the lineup was now solid. It was recorded at the Great Trident Studios in Soho, which Bowie and lots of different people used to use. The Beatles used it, in fact, as well. And they had a producer, John Anthony. And I think the whole thing was more cohesive. So they'd got together, not to add on to Peter's tracks, but as a band.
It's very much more sophisticated. The recording technique is very much more polished. The songs are more geared to the band. You have Jackson now, the final element, stirred into the mix, the final bit of alchemy. And you have Nick Potter.
Yeah, it was the first proper Van de Graaff Generator album, as far as I'm concerned. And the record company were very much behind us, which was great. There was like a huge feeling of momentum within the band, you know, we were kind of unstoppable.
H to He Who Am The Only One is one of these convoluted Van de Graaff titles.
I'm sure they came up with that song album title one night when they were drunk.
H to He Who Am The Only One, yes. Not only did Van de Graaff make sometimes difficult music, they also had difficult album titles as well.
H to He actually stands for hydrogen to helium, and that kind of sets up the album. It's a difficult.
It has the lot, and I don't just like it because it's got one of my tunes there in Killer. It has some splendid songs. They really are terrific. And it's got Van de Graaff Generator doing what Van de Graaff Generator did. Going at a good tune and dismembering it, turning it inside out, playing it backwards.
It's almost like an instrumental free-for-all. Everybody's playing off each other. Nobody really seems to know what the other one's going to be doing. And I think that's part of the attraction. You know, I think, you know, they surprise the listener by going off on these tangents. And secretly, I think you're surprised as well because you think they don't know what they're doing either.
H to H, you've got more complex melodies. You've got more diverse lyrics, more different zones, you know, space. I was writing lots of nasty harmonies, vicious, aggressive harmonies in writing things like that. I mean, so frightening that one of my girlfriends at the time used to cover her child's ears.
Van de Graaff are steering away from the more traditional progressive sound that bands like Yes and Genesis were playing. They were carving out their own little niche, which was much more esoteric. It's certainly an acquired taste.
H2HE is my favourite all-time Van de Graaff Generator album. And I think the track Lost on the album is perhaps my favourite all-time song or track that we did, you know. So I think H to H is a great album.
It just has all the elements beautifully controlled. I think it's a wonderful album. Theme one is a real oddity. The tune started life as the theme music for Radio 1 when it first started. And the band had been doing it as an encore, tongue-in-cheek encore. But it came out as a single and was a huge hit.
I play the tune and Hugh plays all the harmony and incredible improvisation, multiple parts that he has to play. Guy plays a steaming drum track all the way through it. And the record company were right. It was a hit, and it was a hit in Italy. So, you know, it could, you know, it did. It opened the door for Van de Graaff to a much wider audience.
So it's just David Jackson, Guy Evans and Hugh Banton. And Banton is playing bass pedals anyway to mask the... Well, to cater for the fact they don't have a bass player.
I personally, on that, on theme one, don't really miss the bass that much. It's a very strong melody. And David Jackson and Hugh Banton, who are playing the melody, play it very well. And Guy Evans, as I said, is a great drummer. And he's sort of free to be a bit more, I suppose, jazz-like in his approach to the playing on that particular track. And it worked.
If theme one had been recorded by Van de Graaff Generator about 5 years earlier, it probably would have fitted into the style of that particular era in terms of slightly psychedelic, slightly keyboard-led and slightly upbeat tempo. But because it came out in the mid-70s, at a time when the charts were dominated by the likes of Slade, T-Rex, Mudd, etc., it didn't fit at all. It was completely different to everything that other people were doing in terms of chart success. But then that's Van de Graaff Generator.
It completely passed me by, theme one, I think. Maybe it was because it was so atypically Van de Graaff that I didn't really notice it at the time.
It's probably just as well it wasn't a hit, because I think if Van de Graaff Generator had a novelty hit early on in their career, that would have screwed them right up.
A Plague of Lighthouse Keepers is the masterwork, as far as I'm concerned, for Van de Graaff Generator.
Plague of Lighthouse Keepers is widely regarded as the jewel in Van de Graaff Generator's crown.
It's certainly their most intense and confusing hour.
It's over 20 minutes in length, and it's a magnificent story.
For me personally, it probably is their greatest achievement.
I think it was something that was waiting to happen. I am a lonely man, my solitude is true. My eyes have gone stark with us, and now my nights are numbered. As far as I remember, it was a complete surprise when we got to the TV studio to find out that we were playing A Plague of Lighthouse Keepers. It was not what we thought we were there for to do. We thought we were just going to play our set. And so we had a crisis meeting and we decided we could do it in two halves. So they did one half with sparklers and one half with candles. And that's what we did. In hindsight, of course, you know, watching that performance, it's exceptional. It is exceptional. It's a fantastic feeling, because we would never try our hardest to get across the point, you know, to get across the emotion, because the tunes are very, they're very emotional. They're very, very beautiful. The opening theme is absolutely divine. It's one of my favourite tunes, Peter's tunes. And the end, of course, is a very, very uplifting anthem.
Plague of Lighthouse Keepers is a 23-minute opus that was divided up into 10 different sections, which had such sort of curious titles as Custard's Last Stand or The Clot Thickens, which I suppose is what for Van de Graaff passes as humour.
But of course, length isn't always everything. And, you know, you can lose your way very easily. You get bits where the band do the jazz thing, you know, we hope you like our new direction, Jazz Odyssey kind of off in all directions. But see, the great thing about it is it always keeps on drawing back to a central theme, and climaxes quite superbly.
I think the final piece, which is called We Go Now, that melody, was perhaps the starting piece, and I actually wrote that piece as my music. And I think Peter was very taken with that melody. I think he was very taken with him, although I didn't get to play on it. This is somewhat ironic, you know. You wouldn't let me play up, no. Can I play a little? No. Don't need you on that bit. Okay, all right.
Lighthouses, my town's the key. What can I find?
This is a self-contained story. This is a story of a lighthouse keeper and how he deals with death, with life, with not being able to save ships that crash on the rocks, with not bothering to save some ships that crash on the rocks. It's got guilt, it's got frustration, it's got agony, it's got angst. It's a wonderful piece of work.
There's some mad ideas. There's some beautiful melodies. There's some very, very powerful things.
All the complicated bits, the sudden changes, are there for a reason. They're there for a musical reason, and they carry the story on. They carry the meaning of the lyrics on further. And the playing on it is just amazing throughout.
Now, that doesn't seem very much, but it's like an absolutely mad march. But you put, everybody starts playing that with all the harmony and all the rhythm and all the ingredients and the insane rhythm. And it just becomes a march of the mad zombies. It's absolutely exhilarating to play.
His musical hallmarks, I suppose, are the fact that you get songs, you get instrumentals, sections, that are in different time signatures, and it goes back to sort of more standard 4/4 basic songs. Then you get sound effects, you know, experimentation, bit of sort of jazz type of improvisation, squeaks, thumps and bangs as well. And then back to another song, and then, you know, maybe the finale, you know, being a bit mixture of a bit of vocals and a bit of instrumental. So it was a mix and match of all their musical styles into one long piece.
It's just an incredibly impressive piece of music because it features quite disparate musical styles within the whole piece, and yet it all works as one piece of music. And that's the you know, it was obviously the great trick that not a lot of bands could pull off, but the best of them, like Van de Graaf Generator, could do it.
You listen to Lighthouse Keepers, it's very good, but there are parts which are quite disjointed within it. And I think that's fairly obvious that's going to happen. I mean, Peter Hamill wrote this as separate songs or separate parts, and then the band pulled it together.
One of the elements that the band brought to it was that at various times you would have half the band playing one section of the piece, while the other half of the band played another section of the piece. Now, strange as it may seem, it did actually work at times, although you had to be concentrating pretty carefully to get it.
It's quite breathtaking and quite brilliant in its design, in its complexity, and in its execution. And I think it's the highlight of Van de Graaf Generator's career. Van de Graaff split up after Pawn Hearts and Peter Hammer went solo for a couple of years. And then he felt it was time to reorganise Van de Graaff, as it were. I think to reunite or reform is probably not the right term for someone like Hamill.
There was a new energy, you know, like they'd found it was time that they wanted to be with each other again. And I think God Bluff was one of those moments. They'd come back, there's a lot of energy. A lot of the ingredients were still there, the unusual time signatures. You know, the musicians basically weren't going to change that much in the few years that they hadn't been working together as Van de Graaff Generator. But they were bringing fresh ideas in as well. And I think that is reflected in the whole of the record. And it's a very focused record.
Between me and you, my constant friends, ever close at hand.
To me, it sounds like it's just seamless development and progress from the previous album. I think this is them at the top of their game.
We didn't work with a producer anymore, so we were grown-ups now. We didn't need to be told how to record or how to mix or how to, you know, even how to start laying down tracks. All of the things that we had to be taught. We knew all of that, so you know, it was a very exciting time. But we went in there and we just banged things down. You know, we did more than an album in a couple of weeks, you know. We did God Bluff and some of Still Life, you know. We did another couple of extra tracks. So we even had choice. And for the first time in our life, we were ahead in terms of our contractual obligations. We had repertoire. I think the feeling that we were working faster and we were thinking more about playing live now. More of a live feel to our recordings, I think, then.
Scorched Earth certainly lives up to its title. It's a remorseless vortex of sounds and textures that builds with a kind of anarchy running underneath it, certainly vocally. It's almost shades of Mark E. Smith and The Fall, curiously enough. And then it gets to a sort of magisterial interlude before it builds up once again to an awesome finale.
The end of that, of course, is, it's in my humble opinion, it's the mastery of Hugh Banton, because it's probably one of those things where he said, look, you know, we've got all this stuff to resolve, da-da-da-da-da-da, all these different ideas and things, I can't remember what they all are because there's about 10 more ingredients that go into it. Resolve them all, fuse them all back into each other, change key 100 times in some stressful hypnotic resolution, and you know you've got a blinding end, and put and find a rhythm, an underlying drum thunder that can go through this 4 minutes of devastating conclusion, and you've got Van de Graaff writing at its peak, really, and it's an incredible piece to play.
The Scorched Earth, I think, is I suppose you could describe it as Van de Graaff Generator at full throttle, really. It's where all their complex arrangements really come together. I think if you played Scorched Earth in isolation to somebody who'd never heard Van de Graaff before, that would probably sum up the band pretty well.
I mean, it's got all the elements there up and running. It's got the compound time signatures, it's got the brain scrambling bits of musicianship, it's got the big tune, it's got the monster riff. Van de Graaff Generator, business as usual.
It's got basically a triplet feel to it, but it's got bars of 4-4, 5/4 and 7/4. So not unusual for a Van de Graaff generator. And it starts with a sort of very anthemic sort of theme at the beginning, and then moves off into all these different sort of layers of sound.
You've got 20th century classical music, you've got contemporary jazz, you've got psychedelia, you've got, most importantly I think, you haven't got any showy displays of instrumental expertise, which characterised a lot of the progressive rock bands of that period. You know, somebody would suddenly go off on a, you know, 3-hour keyboard solo. There's none of that. It's just very, very compact, very well thought out, and very mature sounding.
Sleepwalkers ends the Godduff album in style. It has the same awesome build-up going on with it, but there appear to be a few more jaunty moments. They are able to relax for a moment and let a few more musical interludes, lighter musical interludes, intrude.
The first half is very restrained, very delicate, with Banton and Jackson kind of dancing a little minuet round each other.
It is just on and on, streams of consciousness, and you don't, the rhythms are complex and changing, the structure is weird, but it's not weird if you understand Peter and you understand the lyrics. It's kind of building blocks. It's building blocks of themes and developments and key changes. What wonderful arpeggios. I know, because then they're not expected intervals, and they're lovely fourths and fifth intervals all the way. Big steps in music that, you know, that open everything up. Great big steps that create this open landscape to which you can put the tune right down the middle.
And then you get this extraordinary thing. You get a Van de Graaff generator joke. You get a bit of cheesy come dancing music, which is very, very funny, and it's also very expertly done. Not what you expect to hear.
It's fun. I mean, it's just fun. It's humorous, but for some reason it makes a very poignant statement in the story. It's a story, really. Not that I ever really understood it.
But. And then the second half of the song is the same tunes, the verse and the chorus and the middle eight, but it's done in a more regular, hard rocking style. I think it's a brilliant piece of work.
The main thing about the Godbluff album, and in particular this track, is there's quite a strong musical theme running through the record. And also, his lyrics had got a little lighter at this point. Everything was a little bit more melodic than it had been in the past. There's four tracks on the album. I don't think Sleepwalkers is particularly one that stands out above the others. I think they've all got their merit on that album.
I think for Van de Graaff fans, Godbluff was probably the ultimate comeback album for them. I don't think they could have done any better. They certainly, I think, pleased their hardcore following by, you know, being typically indulgent and intense or whatever. But there was a degree of accessibility there also that I think had been missing previously.
They came back a more disciplined band. They came back with more of a vision of how to work in a studio, how to be a proper band. And because of that, I think, although Godbluff is much slicker, much smoother and much more cohesive as a piece of work, it doesn't have what those earlier albums had. So personally, for me, it was an extremely disappointing comeback, although it's raved about by almost the rest of the world because it has so much good music on it. But to me, no, sorry, I don't think they should have reformed.
God Bluff for me is a bit too heavy and kind of discordant and not really, you know, not my favourite album at all, frankly. Not my cup of tea, really.
It's only got four pieces of music on it, and all four pieces are very, very good. But I still would say that not one of them is better than the classic material from the first phase of their career. It's a worthy comeback. It's not a pointless comeback, but it's certainly not, you know, the be-all and end-all of Van de Graaff Generator's career.
Van de Graaff Generator, you can't actually quantify in terms of rated, overrated, underrated. They're all three. They're rated by those who know and understand them. They're underrated by those who've never heard them because they haven't heard them. And everyone should hear Van de Graaff Generator. And they're overrated by those who put this mark of genius on them. They weren't geniuses.
Had they been briefly successful, they would have gone back to obscurity again. As it was, they remained a powerful